Turn them on, it's fine. Let's do it. It is. Let's turn it on some more. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your overwhelming, reckless love, as the song says, Lord. What a great praise and worship. Lord, we love to worship you. So, Father, I pray that, as always, tonight, you snag somebody up. You reach into somebody's Egypt. We pray for salvations. We pray for healing. And, Father, you just have your way. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Welcome. The last installment of the series Identity Crisis. So if you were here for the first 2 weeks, we talked about, the first week we talked about our spoken words and how not only our own spoken words, but the spoken words of others that we come into agreement with can affect our identity and who we are. It can affect our behavior. It can affect our conduct. And a lot of it's been about spoken words. And, you know, when I was trying to get prepared for tonight, I don't think there was anything that could prepare me for tonight. This is a Cliff Notes version or a condensed version of what, Lord willing, will happen on a Sunday morning. And so I didn't know how to prepare for tonight. And Lord help me. I know that a lot of you know my daughter Samantha. And when the Lord gave me the name of this message, I didn't know for certain that she was going to be helping me with it. But he showed me some things over the last couple of weeks, and this has been something that's been ongoing in her life for a long time. And I'll tell you what we're going to do. We're going to start it off with this. Samantha is going to, she's going to read something that she wrote to you guys and get started. So everybody give it up for Samantha.
So, Lord, I want to read you a story about a little girl. There was once a little girl to whose mother's left her so early in life that she doesn't even remember meeting her. She was also too young to remember how she got the cigarette scar on her body. What she does remember is the male family members used her poor, innocent little body to do disgusting things. And she remembers wondering if all those things were normal. When the little girl was 5, her dad was drunk and stopped in the middle of the road and kicked her out of his life forever. Little did she know that she was, as she was standing there crying, that her life was about to change. A neighbor picked her up and carried her inside. They took her in, fed her, cleaned her up, and gave her a place to sleep. The little girl had no idea what to expect or if her dad was ever coming back. Although she felt safe at first, when she tried to speak, they would beat her with a bamboo stick and to tell her to keep quiet. It didn't take long for her to become a silent little girl, never sharing a happy thought or asking questions like the other kids. She remembers wondering if all these things were normal. The family that took her in owned a greenhouse business in a small Buddhist community. The little girl was forced to work each day from morning to night or be severely punished. She was never paid or rewarded, only beaten for poor performance. She remembers wondering if all those things were normal. As a child growing up in the family business, she has a vague memory of random men showing up in her bedroom at night. Afraid to speak, fear of being beaten, she just never told anybody. She just assumed all these things were normal. The family had enrolled the little girl in school and threatened her to never talk to other kids. Out of fear, she never spoke in school. She was placed in special education classes labeled as disabled. Never, ever being taught to read, yet they kept passing her through each grade. She remembers seeing all the little girls laughing, playing, and seeming happy. I wondered if they were able to, why were they able to smile that much, what they were going through at home. She just assumed that everybody was being used as a slave and dealt with it in their own ways. As the little girl grew up, they began to work harder in the greenhouses. And the summers were especially hard. There were no vacations, no family road trips, or even game nights. Only a scorching hot sun and another day of work to look forward to. There was no Santa Claus, no birthday celebrations, or roller coaster rides, or even zoo visits. There was no loving laughter or compassion in her house. There were just hard work, abuse, and a bamboo stick. That's all that little girl ever knew. She after wondered if that was all normal. Anytime something in the household or in the business went wrong, they blamed her. Eventually, they started to label her as bad luck and would beat her for causing bad things to happen. The family always told her that she was no good, and they convinced her that she would never amount to anything, and that she would only ever be a good at working in the fields. As she grew older, workers from the family business began to brutally assault the little girl. She never understood why, she just thought it was all normal. Talking to someone wasn't even something she considered. She just assumed all the little girls had to live the same life that she was living. At 13 years old, the family continued to have horrible curses in their lives and in their family business, and constantly blaming the little girl because they believed her to be bad luck. And they tried to give her away to anyone that would take her. Everyone said no. No one wanted that little girl. The little girl was lost, defeated, scared, and abused, and hurting, and had no hope. She was in this vicious cycle with no way out. She was unwanted, and nobody to help her, nobody to cry out to. The little girl in this story is me. That little girl is me. I remember at night, I would sit on this big old window above my bed. And I remember sitting there at night and reciting this poem that I heard over a cartoon or something. And as silly as it sounds, I would always rehearse this poem, and it was basically like, star light, star bright, the first star I see tonight, I wish I might. And then I would wish whatever I was wishing that night. And I remember always wishing for this one wish, that someone or something would help me get out of here. Of course, I didn't really believe any of it. I just assumed that I was always going to be stuck here, and I was never getting out of here. Well, then I was 15 years old, and Hurricane Harvey hit. And I remember it was just all flooded, and it had destroyed everything that we had. And I remember as transportation, we just had to get in kayaks and get where we needed to go. Well, then, all of a sudden, these people started showing up, and I was like, they're just over the people. Like, where are all these people coming from? And they were helping us get out of the place and moving us to safety and stuff like that. And I remember them I remember them calling themselves Christians, and I didn't really know what that meant, but I knew there was something about them that was different, and I can feel it. And I remember wanting the urge to know them more, and just feeling that desire. But I always kept my distance. I was like, I'm good. You can stay over there. I'm just going to keep you from afar. So suddenly, that was all happening and all that stuff. And I remember in this mix of the crowd, I remember this one man. This man was like sort of the leader, and he was telling the volunteers what to do and where they needed to be. And he called himself a preacher or whatever. And he kept on talking about this Jesus guy. And I kept wondering, why is this man showing up out of nowhere and then talking about this Jesus guy? And he seemed so hyped about it. And he was like, hey, he's pretty cool. And I remember seeing him all the time around. I never had talked to this guy. I remember seeing him around working all the time and volunteering. And sometimes he was with the volunteers or he was by himself. My family's new job at the time was to help the preacher and help him. Sorry, I just like left my train of thought. So be gracious to me. My family's new job was to assist this preacher and help him whatever he needed to help with. Well, and I remember being told to help him so that he will build our house for free. And keep in mind, our house wasn't even that bad. It was just like the bottom floor, and that was about it. That's the only thing he needed to help us with. But our family's mindset was, hey, if you get on his good side, he will start building you stuff for free. And each night, this preacher had meetings in this house next door to us. So it was my house and then the house next door to us, and we called it the Yellow House. And the preacher would go there every day, every night, and talking about this Jesus guy. And I remember being forced to go to just participate and stuff so that you can see us there and be like feel like that we cared. But then I was always told a reminder, hey, do not go there and believe what they were saying, because we believed in Buddha and that's about it and that's how it needs to be. So over the months, they were starting to become more college students, and they started coming down and helping and stuff like that, and there were also younger people there. And the preacher guy just kept on talking about this guy named Jesus. And I remember just sitting there and wondering, who is this Jesus guy and why is this guy talking about him like he's so great? Because in the back of my mind, I was saying, well, then why is my life so horrible? Why were they getting all the blessings and I was having to live like a slave? Was it because they were doing all these good deeds and this Jesus guy was like rewarding him? These were all the thoughts I was getting through my head, and I never really asked anybody those questions because I was just afraid of being in trouble and my family would have heard it and just would have just caused chaos. And I remember feeling so arrogant and rude for not even saying anything. And I remember these Christian people being so sweet to me, and I had never had ever experienced that before. So I didn't know how to react to that. Well, the next following day, I was helping this preacher guy build sheetrock and helping him assist him with everything that he needed to do. Well, I found myself slowly started asking him questions about like this Jesus guy. And yeah, it didn't really make any sense, but I was like, I felt the desire to still want to know more about what he was talking about. And he was acting all surprised because this is my first time ever interacting with him. I see him walking around this dirt road, and that was about it. And so he was surprised I was even asking the questions and interested in the questions, like the answers he had for me. Well, one night, their preacher guy was having another meeting, and he started taking this little girl to this fish trough, okay? So my family also owned a greenhouse business, and they also owned a fish company. Well, the fish company had like live wells and stuff like that, and they had these big old water troughs, and there were like these big old live wells, okay? Well, this preacher man decided, he wanted to fill up one of those fishy troughs and fill it up with water and put this little girl in there. And I was like, okay, he's a little crazy, and I don't know what he's doing, but he seems crazy. And I already think he's crazy enough because he keeps talking about this Jesus guy. Well, I don't know where he started dunking this girl in the water, and I was like, this guy's literally trying to drown this little girl, and she seems all excited and happy about this. I'm like, okay, what is going on? Well, me thinking that was crazy, he literally next day later started bringing more kids get baptized, and they started being all excited and happy about it. Well, then the craziest thing was like the people from my community that believed in Buddha was literally getting baptized also. And I remember them just coming out of the water and all excited, and they started to look like these Jesus people and these Christians. And I remember looking at all of that and wondering if all of that was normal. Well, and then the next very following day, the preacher pulled me aside and he said he felt the Lord asking me or inviting me to get baptized. Yeah, at the time I did believe what he was saying, but also no one has ever wanted me, so why would this Jesus guy even want me? So on Monday night, it was May of 2018, it was a long day of working, and I was being told to go next door because they were having the meeting or whatever. And I was walking to the door. There was like so many college students, even high school kids, even my age, people were going there that day. And I remember they began singing this song, Reckless Love. And I remember actually knowing the words to the song and singing along. And I remember feeling the urge to stand up and asked to get baptized. But I was also too afraid to say anything. So I remember sitting back down, and this, keep in mind, the preacher guy is still a little talking about whatever he's talking about. Well, as I was sitting there, I remember asking the Lord, I said, Jesus, if you're really there, and supposedly you're real, do something to show me that you're real. And I'm not sure what that preacher was talking about that day, but I remember him stopping mid-sentence, and he was like, I feel like the Holy Spirit is calling someone to read Psalm 27:10. And he kept shouting that out, and he said, will someone please read that? And I remember this girl standing up, and when she was speaking those words, I'm telling you, I will literally never forget that, because I literally have it tattooed on my arm. Guess how much powerful that it was to me. But I remember someone reading this, and it said, when my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will take care of me. And I knew right there that Jesus was speaking to me right there. Like he had thought of those words a million years ago and placed them in that Bible just for me to read that day. Those words touched my heart so much and like rang so true in my heart that I knew with all my heart that Jesus would keep that promise to me. I remember standing up in front of those people with something. I felt like I needed to say something. I remember just nothing just came out of my mouth. Nothing just literally did not. I was just standing there and just nothing was coming out. And I remember this preacher just calling out my name as if like I had something like, hey, like, do you have something to say? And I remember just saying, I believe in Jesus and I'm ready to get baptized. And that's exactly what they did. They started cheering and clapping and yelling, all that stuff. And I was like, I just said a word. Why are you screaming and laughing and stuff like that? Why are you so excited about some word I just said? And we didn't even continue the meeting. We just started walking next door to my family's house to tell them the good news. And as we were walking down this dirt road to the house, the preacher started to knock on the door. And there were about like 50 kids standing outside of the door, so excited, like really thrilled to like, hey, you know, tell the good news. Well, when that preacher knocked on a door and the man opened it, which is my father at the time, he said, sir, Samantha has given her life to Christ and wants to get baptized. I remember it being so awkwardly silent, and the man looked at me and he said, if you do this, you are no longer a part of this family and you're disowned, and don't ever come back here. And he slammed that door in my face. And I remember it being so quiet, and it didn't hit me at first, and then immediately I just started crying. And that preacher just awkwardly stood and he was like, maybe we should just come back another day and just like tell him later, you know, and get baptized later. And I remember everybody else just standing there too and just assuming that it was just tears of sadness and just me upset about the whole situation. And maybe I was. But I remember it just was that overwhelming feeling about everything. And I remember looking at that preacher and I said, please, I really want to do this now. I don't care what he just said. I still want to do this right now. And I remember just being so excited inside, and I didn't really understand, and nobody else understood why, because I was the only one that knew what would happen. The man holding me as a prisoner just told me getting baptized would set me free. And I was like, well, sign me up. Like, where's the water? Let's get this over with. And that preacher, he kept reiterating this. And he was like, but did you just literally hear him? He said you literally will have nowhere to go. And I remember looking at him and I said, it's okay. Jesus just adopted me. And that preacher didn't argue anymore. He had baptized me that night. And as I was coming out of the water, the group of college students were singing Reckless Love over me. And I knew with all my heart that this was my new normal. So as I was done, we started walking down this dirt road passing. So there was the warehouse with the big old fish troughs, okay? And then there was my house, and then there was Yellow House, and that was the meeting place. So as we were walking past, we had to pass the house I was living at the time. And as I was walking past it and looking at that house, I was like, dang. And it just started hitting me like a ton of bricks, like, I literally have nowhere to go. I'm 15 years old, I can't read or write, and I had nothing but the wet clothes on my back. I was walking down this road and just nothing. And I remember looking at this preacher and I said, sir, will you please take care of me? Not only did that preacher take care of me, but that preacher is my dad. When I thought I was reciting a poem and wishing to stars, I was actually praying to a Jesus I didn't even know yet. And Jesus answered those little girls' prayers. And that song that they just sung about reckless love is so true about Jesus, because it literally says, there's no shadow he won't light up, no mountain he won't climb up, no wall he won't kick down, or lie he won't tear down, coming after you. I heard one Bible verse and believed it. Literally, Jesus sent a hurricane to destroy a whole entire community just to come get me. Imagine what he will do in your life if you just believe in him.
man, here's how the Holy Spirit works. No one asked the band to play Reckless Love tonight. I didn't, she didn't, and they just played it. That's the Holy Ghost. And there's so much more to this story. I want to read a scripture that the Lord put on my heart. So, hallelujah, if you're out there and you need this. I might have you read it. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God. Okay. These are sons of God, for you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. My goodness, if God is for us, who can be against us? So everything she just said is very accurate, and there's a lot more to it. Like I said, this was a condensed version tonight, but I want to share a little bit about what happened immediately after that. I didn't go to Houston and volunteer hoping to pick up a brand new teenager. And so, and for a solid year, this little girl would not leave my side. And I don't mean like, I mean 6 inches beside me. And if I turned around to walk away, she'd go, where are you going? Where are you going? And here's, she started telling me things and talking to me about things that are not normal. As a grown man with a new 15-year-old that doesn't belong to him, and no one had custody of this girl, no one had legal authority of this girl, we located her birth mother. She was able to sign a document that allowed me to bring her to Atlanta, Georgia, where we found her. And when we were in Atlanta, Georgia, her mother signed over all the rights to her child to me. And so that is also how the Holy Spirit works. And on that trip with some women in ministry, we had a conversation about some things she'd been going through. And so obviously I had to get Child Protective Services involved and some other people involved, and they did a forensic psych eval on her, and I remember the lady from CPS when she was done, and I was so worried about her. When she was done, she sat me down and she goes, don't you ever take this little girl back to that neighborhood. I was worried about her education. She was 15 years old and couldn't read or write. She was failed by the education system. I went into the school where she attended, and they, as she sat beside me, they told me that she was disabled to her face. She was in special education classes. Then how is she passing if she can't read? And so I immediately, I didn't immediately take her out. We moved. I sat her down and spent a summer with her in this book right here, in a children's illustrated Bible. Taught her how to read. It's the first book she ever read from cover to cover. You still reading kids' Bibles? Oh, I'm sorry.
No, I now read.
It's okay. You don't have to answer. But you turn it on because I got more questions for you. her mic's not working.
Oh, no, it's working.
There you go. So, it turned out when she could read stuff, she's pretty smart. And so when I went to enroll her in school, they looked at her, transcripts, and they wanted to put her in special ed. And I said, nope, we're not doing that with her. But they refused to accommodate what I was asking, regular classes. So they put in remedial classes that didn't count. She aced them. So they let her put they let her go into regular classes, and she aced them. And so her sophomore year, they put her in honors classes, again made all A's. Junior and senior year, put her in honors classes, again made all A's, and she graduated with honors in the top 10 of her class. There was something else I wanted to say. I'm going to brag on her for, oh yeah. So then she graduates and she goes to work back here at the school. And where she worked for 2 years as a teacher's aide, and tell them what you did over there.
My job at the time was to actually teach other kids how to read.
She sat down with the kids who were struggling and taught them how to read. And there were a ton of first times. Okay, this is a teenager. Like, she's turning 16. We're talking about driver's licenses and stuff like that. And she ain't never been to a zoo or ridden a roller coaster. Or what else? What's some first time stuff?
He took me to get pedicures. And
never had a pedicure.
And we went shopping and had like sleepovers.
Never had a sleepover with friends, no movie nights, no game nights, no Santa Claus, no birthday celebrations. Like, it was like starting over with a child.
And an elf on a shelf. And I remember him breaking my heart, telling me the news about that.
Oh, hold on, listen, that's not how it happened at all.
Whatever.
Okay, I have to tell y'all this quick story about the elf on a shelf. Is Jordana in this room? You in trouble, girl, where you at? Oh boy. So, anyways, she is 17 years old. All right. All through 16, we did the elf on a shelf. Total believer. Believer in the elf on a shelf. And then his name was Cookie. Well, the next year, she wanted to get a girl one, so we had two elves on the shelf. This girl thought she was slick. She was like, she would like put her phone out at night to video it and all kinds of stuff. I never got caught. Well, one day, we're driving somewhere, like on a vacation, we're going fishing, I don't remember, but she saw a post, Jordana posted, I forgot to move the elf or something like that. She's 17. I'm like, okay, just one more Christmas. This is the last one, and I'll tell her, right? She starts bawling, crying. And parents, this is a wake-up call. Get ready. She starts bawling, crying to me about that. Hey, man, you did it. I said, Samantha, come on now. You're 17 years old. You really think that doll's moving around you at night and flying back in the north? You believe that? And she looks at me, and she goes, crying. She goes, I believed you about Jesus. So, wake up calls, mom and daddy. It has been an interesting life together, though. For me, it's like growing up again and being a kid, because I got to experience and walk her through these things she had never experienced. And I absolutely love it when we do something, and literally we just be sitting there doing something. She'll go, yep, this is the first time I ever did this. And the things that we take for granted, she never knew existed. She thought that wretched, dark place was normal for everyone. And what just tore me up is when she said, I wondered how all the other little girls were always so happy and smiling and laughing. I guess they just dealt with it in their own way. Man. Let me ask you some questions. How do you see yourself? How do you see your identity right now?
I would say the Bible and church and just our young adults group and stuff like that, just surrounding my friends, being surrounded by them, and just serving.
Fair enough. That's pretty much the lifestyle for sure. Okay, so what is your message. What's your message? What do you want people to know?
I would say my message is to believe. Because I'm literally standing in front of you right now, living proof that you can stand really, really strong in the Word of God. Because I remember all those nights of coming to watch you preach and all that stuff, not even knowing, understanding what the heck he was even talking about. I just remember.
That happens on normal Wednesday nights as well.
Okay. Anyways, I remember hearing him say this one Bible verse, literally just one Bible verse. And I believed it. Jesus literally changed my whole entire life. And that's a really good example about how powerful the Word of God is. Because I can tell you right now, there's nothing anybody can say or do to tell me or to convince me that Jesus isn't real. Because he literally gave me just one little Bible verse. And he turned my life upside down.
Well, amen.
Actually, let me rephrase that. He turned my life right side up.
Amen. That's powerful. And that's a true story. And we were sitting in a devotional, and I thought she was arrogant, little stuck up, never talked. That's what I thought about her, because she never spoke. And I could walk up to her and say words, and she'd just stare at me. I did not know that she was afraid she'd get beat if she opened her mouth. And that's how she had been trained since a little girl. So she just didn't talk. And it's so ironic. She would come in, and she would sit there and not speak, not participate. But that definitely is a true story, as I was speaking, and I didn't have my Bible in my hand. It was sitting over here, and I was like, "What's Psalm 27:10? Somebody read it. Anybody, get up." And somebody read it, and that's when this one hopped up. And that's powerful, because this faith come by hearing. Man, she heard like 8 words, and Jesus, and she believed those 8 words, and Jesus said, "That's enough. I'm coming to get you." Man, that was so powerful. I'll say this at if y'all have heard, some of y'all have heard some of my testimony, and I was in the middle of had just ended a 10 or 12 year long custody battle for my daughter Natalie, and she couldn't stand me. She didn't want anything to do with me. Even though I won in court and made her come see me, she didn't want anything to do with me. And I can tell you this. You being around and her seeing that everything she had been told all her life maybe wasn't true, and she saw that we had a good relationship, it corrected our relationship. I gained 2 daughters out of it. And I'm not going to, Lord, help me. No, I don't need a tissue. She's... I don't feel very good about it when people come up to me. I really don't, and say, "What a wonderful thing you did for her. What an amazing thing. You go in and save this girl." And Samantha Perry, you saved me. And I'm so thankful for you. If I didn't have you 6 inches away from me for all that time, I don't know what I might have done. And I'm so proud of you. I'm so thankful for you. I'm proud of you for getting up and doing this tonight. From your testimony, if you could share with everybody from your testimony, what's one thing, the thing that you want people to take away from it?
To just let it go, let everything go, and don't waste your salvation in the dark.
I need you to tell me what you mean by that exactly. Don't waste your salvation in the dark.
Well, I can tell you that Jesus means so much to me, and my salvation of how everything just happened and all that stuff means so much to me. So why would I want to waste that? So I guess my message is to just let it all go and let go of all the pain that you're feeling and all that stuff and forgive those people. And to not waste your salvation living in the dark.
So if you, and we kind of talked about this before, so I kind of know, but I want, if you can, in your words, or the best you can, I want you to explain that. I want you to explain it because it's very powerful what you're saying.
Well, if you're a visual learner like I am, I guess if you're harboring unforgiveness and bitterness, that's you choosing to live in the darkness. And the Bible literally says darkness and light cannot coexist. So if you're full of darkness, that's you full of bitterness, envy, spite, and anger. And yeah, I have an excuse. But if I were to just walk around here and pretending like I'm entitled to live in darkness and in anger all the time because of my life being so horrible. But how are you supposed to be the light of the world if you're always so angry and bitter all the time? Because at the end of the day, who wants to live like that? Because I surely don't.
Amen.
And Jesus says to let your light shine before man. So I guess I would say to let go of your past and let go of that darkness and forgive all those people that have done you wrong or looked at you weird or just whatever you could think of. So then you can actually be the light and be the light for other people. Well, I chose to do that, and now I can walk in the fruit of the Spirit, and I can choose love, I can choose joy, I can choose peace, I can choose kindness, I can choose goodness, I can choose faithfulness, and I can choose self-control. So if you can take anything from my testimony, I would say don't waste your salvation. And to let everything go and walk in the light that Jesus is calling you to be.
I'm going to ask the band to come up and do us a favor, please. I have had some notes and stuff, but I'm just don't feel like. Nope. I feel like she just said enough. But I would like to do this. I'm going to ask the band to come up and play Reckless Love again. I'm going to ask that they'll kill the lights. And I'm going to ask that we do one more worship song. I'm going to ask that if you're a minister to come up front and pray for and over people. And I'm gonna ask this. Is there anybody out there that needs to be freed today? If you need to be, I see a hand go up, so you just come on up right now. Hallelujah. The Lord wants to free you from slavery, free you from bondage, and it doesn't have to be physical. If you're not born again, you're walking around in spiritual bondage. You're walking around in spiritual slavery. So if you want to get baptized tonight, if that's you, water trough's full. If you need prayer, we're going to be up here and pray.